Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents Starfist, Book 3, Steel Gauntlet, by David Sherman and Dan Cragg. Read for you by John Bedford Lloyd. Tell me, Gunnery Sergeant Bong, is it true what they say about Marines?
What's that, Madam Proconsul?
Call me Tonga, Gunnery Sergeant. Well, is it true, ma'am, that they're like their swords?
She smiled seductively, then looked quickly at the ceremonial sword fastened by its peace knot to his sword belt. A good Marine is always ready to stand tall for action, ma'am.
Gunny, I think you should take a look at this,
a small voice said in his right ear.
Not now, Winterthur,
he whispered into the throat mic concealed in the high stork collar of his dress scarlets.
Gunny, it's really important.
Excuse me for a moment,
Gunnery Sergeant Bong said with some frustration. He blocked out the sounds and sights of the diplomatic reception that swirled around him.
Take a look at what? This better be good,
he said. Lance Corporal Winterthur's voice sounded nervously bemused behind the buzz of the receiver in Gunny Bong's ear.
Somebody just drove up with a bunch of tanks.
What kind of tanks? Bong asked. Chemical? Storage? Hydroponic?
Don't know their model, Gunny, but they've got turrets with what look like projectile cannons and plasma guns. Looks to be 60 of them.
Bong blinked. Armored vehicles? That's an affirmative, Gunny. You sure they aren't armored personnel carriers? Bong was already walking briskly out of the reception hall, the Honorable Mistress Tongha forgotten. Major Katopskew, the Confederation military liaison, watched him leave.
They're not APCs. They look like something out of a history vid, Winterthur replied over the receiver.
I'm on my way. As soon as Bong reached the corridor, he broke into a sprint toward the main gate 200 meters away.
Tanks? Where could anybody come up with 60 tanks? Where could they be made?
Then Bong stopped wondering about the wheres and started thinking about the whys of tanks at the gate. Throughout history, whenever someone paraded cavalry, drove up in tanks, or surrounded an embassy with infantry or artillery, it usually meant war. Three planet-wide wars had already been fought on Diamunde for control of its wealth, wars big enough that the Confederation Army had to be sent in to fight along with the Marines, who'd originally been dispatched to deal with the situation. The Gunny hadn't fought in any of those wars himself, but he'd served with plenty of Marines who had.
Allah's pointed teeth,
he whispered as he rounded the final corner. A dozen armored behemoths were arrayed under the lights outside the compound, and a lone Marine, blaster held at port arms, stood at attention in dress scarlets in front of the closed vehicle gate. One tank, probably the battalion commander's, stood 5 meters in front of PFC crate. The muzzle of its main cannon pointed directly over his head. In the turret hatch, the tank commander casually stood looking down at the Marine. Bong marched outside to a position in front of PFC crate and looked up at the commander of the lead tank. I am Gunnery Sergeant Bong, commander of the Marine Security Detachment. Can I help you, sir? The tanker leaned a little farther forward over his folded arms so he could look directly at Bong and smiled wolfishly.
We want to go to the party, he said in a voice that crackled with suppressed laughter.
Certainly, sir, I'll be happy to admit you to the reception. May I see your invitation, please? The tank commander barked out a laugh.
I don't have an invitation, he said, still grinning. I want to crash the party.
I'm sorry, sir, but the reception is by invitation only.
I'm quite sure the omission of my name from the guest list was inadvertent, the tank commander said.
He wasn't grinning anymore. Do you know who I am, Gunnery Sergeant? No, sir. I haven't had the pleasure.
I am Major General Marston St. Cyr, commander of the Diamundian Armed Forces.
Sir, Bong brought his right hand up in a crisp salute, but didn't hold the salute for St. Cyr to return. A very polite insult. I'm acquainted with your name. St. Cyr's name figured prominently in dispatches about the deteriorating situation on Diamunde, but Bong had never seen an image of him. He was the head of marketing and of research and development and member of the board of directors of Tubal-Cain Enterprises, the largest of the corporate powers on Diamunde. Sir, if the distinguished head of R&D will bear with me for a moment, I will place a call and attempt to secure permission to admit you.
Well, well, St. Cyr, a new voice cut in. Chief of Staff Whittle stepped through the gate. I see you are as determined as ever to be a thorn in the side of civilized society.
As Chief of Staff, he felt he wasn't always required to be as diplomatic as other members of the diplomatic mission. He didn't deign to look at the tanks.
Whittill, so good of you to meet me.
There was no humor or friendliness in St. Cyr's voice. We are coming in, and then the Confederation will recognize Tubal-Cain Enterprises as the sole legitimate power on Diamunde, and conduct all of its business with me.
We will do no such thing. You may come in, but it will be on sufferance.
By appearing this way, you will convince the few remaining undecideds how unfit you are as someone to deal with. Drop your weapons and follow me. He spun on his heel and began to stride back into the embassy compound. St. Cyr glared after Whittle for a second, then raised his right arm and sharply brought it down. Almost as one, the 60 tanks fired their main guns, then fired their engines to life and rumbled forward, crashing through the cinder block walls. St. Cyr jumped onto his tank as it began moving forward and was climbing back into its cupola as it ran over the vehicle gate. Very few of the 400 people inside the compound were able to flee before the tanks broke through. None of the Marines were among those few. Nor was the ravishing Honorable Mistress Tong.
"Ladies and gentlemen," Cynthia Chang Sturtevant said, "it is my decision, after extensive debate and a voice vote of all the members of the Congress present, having obtained a quorum of votes, that we commence military operations immediately against Diamunde and Tubal-Cain Enterprises." A chorus of angry shouts and denunciations rose from the floor of the Confederation Congress, but they were countered just as loudly by Madam President's supporters on the floor. Fistfights erupted. "Sergeant-at-arms! Sergeant-at-arms!" Madam President Chang Sturtevant shouted. It was 20 minutes before the delegates could be quieted down and put back into their seats. When they had quieted down, President Chang Sturtevant tried again. "We have discussed this in the Council and on the open floor of this Congress. We have discussed this decision endlessly. Each of you has had his turn to speak. The talking is now over. By the authority invested in me under the Confederation Constitution, I hereby declare that a state of war now exists between our member worlds and Diamunde." She slammed her gavel on the podium, caught her breath, stepped down and out the door behind the platform into the private chamber behind the podium.
"Jesus God," she sighed. "I've never seen the bastard so riled, Marcus."
Marcus Berentus, the Confederation Minister of War, smiled and handed her a towel, with which she wiped the perspiration from her face. Madam Chang Sturtevant had been a beauty in her youth, and she still remained a very attractive woman, but there were crow's feet under her eyes now, brown spots on her hands, and the beginning of wrinkles around her neck. She couldn't remember having any of them before she became president of the council. "This war will upset a lot of members' egg baskets, madam, but you had a quorum. Your decision is legal and binding. We go to war. The other ministers support you 100% in this, and the combined chiefs are unanimous that we can defeat St. Cyr quickly and with minimal casualties." She put a hand on his shoulder.
"Marcus, let's hope and pray the brass hats have it right this time."
Admiral Horatio Sea Breeze Perry, chairman of the Confederation Combined Chiefs of Staff, thought he had it right, as he always thought he had it right every time in his career since he'd been an ensign. The briefing he'd arranged for Madam Chang Sturtevant the week before had gone off superbly, except for one annoying little detail.
"Tanks?" Madam President asked.
She thought she hadn't heard General Markham Benteen, commander of the Hephaestus Conglomerate's armed forces, correctly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.